Kind of miss not having a theme sometimes, but I like that one. That one's that's very for any of my Battlestar Galactica heads out there. It's very Battlestar Galactica. Hey, how do you like my sexy, sultry voice today? The allergies are coming back and it's starting to work in my favor. This always happens for like the first day where, you know, I start to sound sexy. Sexy because typically I sound like a woman. Or a they, maybe. Maybe not full woman. Maybe not full manum. Let's bring in E here. I completely just, you know, we were talking about how as we get older, we just forget things. Like there are things right loaded up in the chamber. It's a word I know. I'm ready to say that was probably the most glaring example of what I was talking about. I said woman and then needed to say the opposite of woman and couldn't come up with man. It wasn't there briefly. I mean, it came back immediately because it's such a, you know, front and center word. But that is what I'm talking about. And as my co-host and partner here, E, pointed out, there is no reason for me to know the first name of my seventh grade girlfriend's mom. I need to be able to say the word man in opposition to woman from time to time. But I don't need to know Linda's name. I don't need to remember Linda. Hi, E, how are you? Welcome to High Noon with me, Pugs Moran, and well, you.
Yeah, I'm here. It's high noon somewhere.
It is. Not around these parts. Not around these parts. We are abstaining. This is not called High Noon because, oh, it's a stoner show. That very well may have been the case in recent years, but not now. It's called High Noon because this is like, come on. The movie High Noon, Gary Cooper, you know, the shootout at High Noon. This is a shootout of topics. We give them to you. Anything people are talking about, if it's trending on, I don't care, man. Google, Reddit, Twitter. Oh, wow. I just said Reddit with my allergy voice and it sounded like I was making frog noises, didn't I?
It did.
Reddit. So as you can see, I'm a little bit pumped up because I woke up this morning with the allergy thing happening and I took one of the good pills. So we will not be having an incident like a couple of weeks ago where I took a double dose of dollar store over the counter, which is really, you know, it's supposed to be. There it goes again. Linda, my seventh grade girlfriend's mom wants to come out, but I need to find the word for allergy medication, which is antihistamine. It is like an over-the-counter antihistamine, and it really screwed me up. So, but I got the medication fixed, and now I'm taking it. I'm taking the good stuff, the good, as the kids call it, and my voice sounds sexy. Does my voice sound different to you?
It sounds a little raspy.
Well, it's always raspy. That's
a little more raspy, I guess.
A little deeper, a little deeper when I say words like Reddit. All right, so those are the platforms we use. Reddit, we use Google, we use Twitter, we use Facebook. Anything that lists the trending topics of the day, that's what we do here at noon. We try and run through them. And let me tell you, yesterday was an amazing day. There was a lot of stuff going on yesterday. Today, not so much. Today is just, well, there's stuff trending, but it's all the idiots, you know, the right-leaning idiots and the left-leaning idiots, and nothing for us in the middle. It's all like, it's been revealed that Trump said, or Rahm Emanuel can't be, it's AOC wore a dress. That's all the shit that's trending right now. We have nothing. Well, that's not true. We do have a couple of good things and we'll get into them. A couple of light things, a couple of things that we can all get behind. But you're an early riser. You've probably been up for like 5 hours at this point, 6 hours at this point, at least. Right. So what have you been exposed to as far as the world? What's happening in your world? Is there anything on top of mind? Like if somebody said to you, Amo, with a gun to your head, Amo, I'm going to blow your effing head off if you don't tell me the most important thing happening in the world today. Go.
The Keeneland yearling sale's about to start.
Okay, there you go. show. I don't know what that is. What is it? See, that's what this show's about. We're learning things. What the hell is the Keenan? Is Keenan?
Keeneland. Keeneland is a race course in Lexington, Kentucky.
Oh, geez, here we go. We're 5 minutes into the show, and it's already his degenerate gambling side taking effect. Go ahead, tell me about what's happening at the track.
And this is where they buy the yearlings that ultimately turn
into. Isn't that that Chinese beer?
No, that's Yingling. I don't know. Yingling or whatever. Or Kirin. I don't know. Anyway, this is where they buy the yearlings that turn into two-year-olds that start on the Kentucky Derby Trail.
Oh.
So I mean, they don't only have to be bought at Keeneland. They can be bought at other places. But here is where the most well-bred horses generally try to be sold.
All right.
And all they're right. About to walk in.
So you're watching. You are totally distracted from what we're doing here, and you are licking your chops at what horse you can buy next. Is that what's happening here?
No, I'm paying attention. They're about to walk in a horse by Justify. I don't know if you remember him. He was the one won the Big Triple Crown, the winner of six of six races, and he's going to start out day two at hip number 200.
What does hip number 200 mean?
Well, that's the horse number that they put on the side of them, and then people start bidding on the horses.
Oh, okay. So it's like this is like a draft, a thoroughbred horse draft, if you will.
Yeah, an auction.
Because I don't know what an auction is because I'm not rich. I just know what a draft is. So these are the hot young prospects that could be potential Derby winners or big time horses in the future. And we're getting them while they're young. We're pulling them right out of.
Right. They walk them into the sales ring and then you got a guy go 30, you know, that kind of thing.
So let me ask you this. So a horse with the pedigree that you, and is that the proper term, pedigree?
Or is it there, is. Yeah.
Okay. So a horse with the pedigree that you just mentioned, the kid, grandchild, whatever, of Justified, a very famous horse, because I can only probably name five horses. And, you know, two of them were ones that lived by me. So, you know.
Mr. Ed?
No. Apples and Carrots. There were two horses that lived by me, and they were named Apples and Carrots. And those would be the two horses that I could name. I could also name Justify. I could also name Secretariat. And I guess there was a Seabiscuit movie. No, I could name Ali Darren Affirmed in Seattle.
There you go. You got a little bit of a memory of horses in there.
Yeah. My grandpa was a bit of a horseman, and I spent some time with him as a kid. So that's why I can only go back to like early 80s horses like Ali Dar and do you remember Jacqueline Klugman? Jack Klugman's horse?
Yeah, Jack Klugman. He had horses. Yeah. Sure.
And Oscar. His horse was named Quincy. It was when he was at the height of Quincy, the medical show that Jack Klugman did. But he had a horse.
MC Hammer had a horse.
Who did?
MC Hammer. He had a horse.
What was his horse's name? Was it
one of them was like Light.
Like Hurt Me or something, or Too Legit. That would be, you know what I mean?
Right. You could see him naming a horse Too Legit to Quit.
Too Legit would be a good name for a horse. That, as a matter of fact, there's got to have been a horse named Too Legit. But yeah, Jack Klugman. Yeah, I mean, he was a big horse guy. My grandpa loved Jack Klugman. So I remember one particular Derby season where we were rooting for Jacqueline Klugman. And that's rare, right? It's a filly. It's a female horse. It's rare for a female to run with the men.
It is. There's been a few females that have won the Derby, a horse by the name of Genuine Risk.
Yeah, Genuine. I could name that one. Yeah.
I remember.
Hey, you know the other one that I remember? Now that I'm thinking about it, because I'm definitely not a horse guy, but I love horse races. Let me tell you something. I will watch the Derby every year. I will watch any sporting event that is 8 hours of party for 2 minutes of competition is exactly what I want. That is spectacular. Just that it's over in 2 minutes. Because I remember my grandpa having these derby parties where everybody would come over and they'd gather around the TV. But the derby was always at like 5 o'clock in the afternoon, but people would start showing up at noon and it was just like a big party. And then everybody would drunkenly gather around the TV and they'd watch, 2 minutes of action. That's actually something that I don't look, man. I like animals. I don't want to get involved in the whole, you're beating animals. Come on, stop it. They look happy. Although, what was the deal with that? Was it, when I say, is this a name? And why does this name have a dark specter over it in my head? Barbarossa.
Barbarossa. Barbaro is the
horse. Oh, I had it.
I think.
That's
yeah,
it.
I think you're in between the Jane Fonda movie.
Barbarella.
Barbarella.
Yes.
And Barbaro. Yeah.
Barbarossa sounds like a horse meat pizza. Does it? Horse meat pizza by Barbarossa.
Oh, so, that'd be ugly.
What is Barbarossa? Why do I remember? Why do I remember that name?
Because that horse, he broke down during the race.
The one that broke its leg and they had to kill it right there on the track.
Well, I don't know that they killed it right there on the track. But
they put a blue tarp up.
Yeah, they got him onto the van and then they probably took him out back and, you know, handled it like old Yeller.
Man. And that's because why? You can't, even in this day and age, we can't fix. Look, let me ask you something point blank, okay?
Sure.
The reason that it's common practice to put horses down after they suffer a serious leg injury, is that because there's just nothing that we can do for it? Or is that because it can no longer earn money?
Oh, it definitely in the case of Barbaro, it was because there was nothing they could do for it. I mean,
so that horse was going to die from its injury. It couldn't just go out and live in a stable for another 10 years.
I think even, and I don't remember if it was him exactly, but I think I remember them trying to do some form of a prosthetic.
Because wouldn't you want the horse semen? I mean,
well, yeah, I mean,
it seemed like it could still be worth something.
He has to be able to, you know, to be, they're not allowed to fall, you know, inseminate them. They have to breed, you know, the actual way that horses breed to the broodmare in order for that to be a thoroughbred that can be able to race. So in horses that you've unfortunately.
Hold on, let me stop you there because I'm seriously interested in this. So, like, you always hear about people buying racehorse semen and injecting it into, like, just a horse. Are you telling me there's like, a rule that it has to be natural sex between two horses for it to be a certain kind of horse?
Unlike the trotters, the pacers, they're allowed to do that type of breeding where they inject the semen in. With thoroughbreds that are going to run as actual thoroughbreds at the track, they have to, you know, broodmare and the stud need to get together and the broodmare needs to carry the horse. And then when she has the baby, the rule is that the baby has to be able to come out, stand and nurse. And at that particular point, let's say, for example, a horse like, you know, Justify, his stud fee might be, you know, $100,000 or more. And so he'll get an opportunity to breed with 100 to 120, maybe as many as 130 horses. He'll cover that many brood mares. And so you do the math, 130 times 100,000.
Oh, yeah. I mean, look, I know there's huge money in that sport, but who gets the baby, the owner of the brood mare or the owner of the
brood mare,
or does the owner of the racehorse own both?
No, the owner of the broodmare will get the baby, but he will have to pay the owner of Justify $100,000 in order to have that baby.
All right. That sounds fair to me, I suppose. Was another racehorse question I just had for you. Oh, yeah. So I once saw years ago, I saw some YouTube video of some big-time racehorse. And they were doing what you described. They were mating it with a broodmare. And there's like a whole process. It's not romantic at all. It looks like an assembly line like there were these rubber bumpers all set up because they were worried about the broodmare kicking. Is that a thing? They're worried about like the broodmare kicking the thoroughbred racehorse that's trying to
mount her from behind.
Yeah, and in this particular YouTube video, the way it was going around is because this broodmare kicked the shit out of this horse, and the horse just wanted nothing to do with it. And it was pretty. Is that common? That seems like a real danger. Unless when it's out to stud, its racing days are over, right? So you're not worried about it being impacted as an athlete.
But
you don't want the horse hurt.
You know, God forbid if she kicked it hard enough and broke its leg. It's no different having a broken leg from being injured than it would be from. you know, injured on the track than it would be from an accident that would happen in the breeding shed. So yes, they are, you know, concerned about the stud being able to keep on making 100,000 times 120 every breeding season. And wow. So they're, you know, very well kept, and, you know, the environment that they're breeding in, is a controlled environment as much as that can be controlled.
Yeah.
A lot of times, there'll be a teaser, stud that, you know, is brought into the room where they're going to breed, or the breeding shed.
Okay.
And he, you know, cause as these studs get older, they get kind of less enthusiastic about, getting on with the broodmare. So it's kind of like him watching a porn with the fluffer.
Horse.
Yeah. They bring this poor little fluffer guy that he gets to come in and take a look at the broodmare, and he gets all revved up. And then right before it's his time,
they bring in the ugly one with the talent for him to mate with.
Yeah. They bring in, you know, the Hugh Hefner, the old stud.
Ew.
And he gets his opportunity, and the fluffer gets sent back to the barn with a cold shower.
All right. Oh, what an awful man. I want to make that children's story. I want to write a children's story about a blue bald fluffer horse.
So I think your question, where you were headed before we got off the track here a little bit, was what would a horse like Justify bred to a broodmare sell for?
Yeah.
And the answer to your question is, first horse out of the gate today at the Keeneland sale, hip number 200, sold for $675,000.
And was that someone with the pedigree of a Justified or just a...
Well, yeah, it was a Justified baby.
Oh, that was a Justified baby. Okay.
It was a Justified baby.
More than one Justified baby?
Yeah, if they breed them 120 times in the year, there's going to be potentially 120 Justified babies.
So
Justified running around.
Justified's just like an NBA player. He's just got a whole bunch of babies out there running around.
Yeah, his life changes dramatically going from the racetrack to going to the breeding shed.
All right. Very interesting. So if we see you pulling out your credit card, that means what? You're buying one online? What are we? I mean, you're gonna. I understand this is a big part of your life. It's we all have hobbies. So if you're going to be distracted today, that's fine.
But, well, I'm just curious to see. Yesterday was the first day of the sale. We're in book number one, and then about to be in book number two. The sale runs all the way from the 13th until next Friday, the 24th. And so as we get deeper into book 3, 4, 5, or 6, the quality of the stud will drop. You know, they won't be as high as stud fees. I mean, some stud fees are as high as $250,000. So, you know, if you've got $250,000 invested in the baby just because it's standed and nursed, you're probably not going to take that horse to a sale and sell it for less than $300,000 or $350,000, trying to get some return on your investment. So a lot of the horses that are in the first two books, their stud fees are, you know, astronomical, and they'll be, you know, bidding going on at a rate that's over the price of the stud, because now you actually have a live baby that's closer to racing.
Jeff Glenn in the chat room would like to point out that he breeds dwarf rabbits, and that we might be surprised to learn they're not very lucrative.
I mean, it would be, I guess, a little bit more lucrative if they had some form of racing, kind of like greyhounds. You know.
All right, let's run through a couple of these things. Like I said, I've got stuff we're going to talk about today. Some of it's trending, some of it's number one, trending number one across just about all platforms, iPhone 13. Are you an iPhone guy?
I am not. I used to be, and then I jumped onto the Android bandwagon, and I've never gotten off.
I'm team Android. I just look, I don't have any real hatred towards Apple phones. It's just that I, like you, I sort of, I guess, learned how to use a smartphone first on an Android. Or no, you had an Apple first, but I learned on an Android. So, I mean, I've always been, I know how it works. I understand the premise. Every time I have to play with somebody's Apple iPhone, I'm lost. You know, I'm like, well, how do you get into your controls? You know, it's like, I have no idea. Everything is just slightly different. And it's not completely different. It's slightly different. So anything that you're conditioned to do on your phone, and when you get a different price, we need to have universal phone layouts. If we're going to be as dependent upon phones as we've all become, we need to have like universal phone layouts. They can do different options. But if I need to like put it on mute, or if I need to turn the volume up, or I need to power off, that shit all needs to be the same. There shouldn't be any tricks to it. That's just me. That's just.
I'm with you. I think a lot of times my frustration with Apple is sometimes it appears like it's so confusing, but then it's so simple that when it's that simple and I don't get it, I feel stupid.
Yes, exactly. And then one day maybe it'll click and you'll hate yourself for feeling so stupid over something that now seems so easy.
Right.
So obvious. So yes, it's a bad sort of karmic thing that goes on here. One of the things that bugs me about iPhone over the Androids, and in my case, I have a Samsung J series. Don't mock me. It's the Toyota Corolla of phones. I have absolutely no issues with this phone. I like this phone. But exactly why iPhone 13 is trending right now is why I don't like iPhones. Every year, they're going to make me feel bad about having last year's model or 2 years ago. I mean, and it's always a huge deal. It's trending number one. It'll probably, highlights from the latest Apple event. The iPhone 13 is revealed. I've had this phone for 3 years. I think I'm going to be a phone owner the way I was raised to be a car owner. You drive a car, you make the commitment to buy the damn car, and then you drive the damn car until it doesn't drive anymore. Or you hand it down to somebody in your family, a kid or something like that, and then you go get yourself a new car. Now, that's just a very working class, I guess, way of looking at it. But I can't keep up with these kids in their iPhone. Do you have the latest iPhone? Oh my, I mean, people get things that men used to be judged on were like, you know, their watch. And that wasn't anything that I was going to. So I don't wear watches because I'm like, I'm not playing that game. You can't keep up on the watch game. What else? Well, and now it's phones is my point. It's like people judge you for your phone. I'm
like, yeah, a new phone is an instant flex, as my kid would call it.
Yes. And it's a dumb flex. It's a totally shallow flex. My phone works fine. Oh, but it's 3 years old. Shut up. What are you, 20? Go away. I've been through bankruptcy. Stop talking to me about this garbage.
My frustration with it is, yes, they change them every year. So that's frustrating. And so I'll get the new phone, and then I'll invest in the OtterBox to protect the new phone. And so when
now you look like a geek, though, because you've got the plastic cover. Although that was originally like you were shunned if you covered up the beautiful artistry of the phone with one of these clunky plastic things until those idiots dropped it on a hard barroom floor and cracked the screen. Those cases are awesome. My kid cannot have a phone without the case.
And so that's my point. So I kind of get where my pissed offness comes when the new phone comes out. It's because I bought the box to protect my phone, and my phone is 100% in perfectly good shape. I've got no reason to want to get rid of this phone other than you're dangling some new phone in front of me.
Ego. They're playing to your ego.
And I feel like it's the people that are flexing.
Yeah, ego.
That aren't smart enough to go buy a case.
Yes.
That free. Now got to go get a new phone because their case looks like dog doo-doo.
Amen.
And if they only would buy a case, we'd stop this nonsense of people coming out with an inversion and everybody buying a new version. And so I'm torn between the, okay, do I get a case now? Because when the next one comes out, I know I'm going to be pissed. And then not only am I going to be pissed, but I'm going to be really pissed when I actually break down to buy one, even if it's 3 years down the road, because they give everybody $50 or $100, some nominal fee for trading in their damn phone. And mine looks like it just came off the showroom floor. And the other guy's looks like it got ran over by a semi, and he's still getting the same amount of money that I'm getting.
Amen.
All right, I'm over.
Amen, brother. No, you're right. You're absolutely right. It is a free card Monty game with these phones now. You are constantly, it's that one. I have the phone. No, the phone you want is over here. Highlights from the latest Apple event. Apple is hosting a virtual event on Tuesday, which is expected to revolve around the iPhone 13, the Apple Watch Series 7, and third generation AirPods. Keep it here for all the highlights. Okay, let me go over that one at a time. iPhones, we've already discussed those. Stop it. That's a con game. That is something they have locked you into buying a new $400, $500 phone, maybe even more, every freaking year. The Apple Watch series, I'll get back to that. The third generation AirPods. AirPods are awesome. The invention of AirPods, Apple AirPods are awesome. They're the only thing that Apple has done in the last few years that make me go, okay, I'll give you a round of applause on that one. Because as someone who wears headphones a lot, I used to have these great Apple, they got stolen out of my car on a pizza delivery. You believe that? They were awesome for running. They were awesome. They were just great. I love them. Now, the Apple Watch series, our extraordinarily tech forward venture, Ed, has an Apple Watch. Have you seen his Apple Watch?
I've seen it. I don't know what it does.
His Apple Watch has a face, you know, the face of a watch.
Right.
It has the old timey clock face on it. I'm like, what? Just get an old timey watch. What are you doing? Are you communicating with people through the Apple? I don't. First of all, the watch is more fashion than anything else. Okay. I mean, that's real. When a man's watch is about fashion, I don't know that it's so much about utility. Everybody's phone that they have clutched in their hand is easier to see the time on than to go like this. I believe, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I think the Apple Watch is definitely a accessory statement, you know, for people to have. It's replaced a lot of the, we'd say, brand name watches. Is kind of a sexier, I guess. It keeps track of your heartbeat. It can show the old school clock.
My phone has all of those apps.
Pedometer.
My phone.
You know, I don't know. I mean.
Does it make calls? Can you make calls from your Apple Watch?
Yeah, and I believe you can answer from your Apple Watch. But your phone has to be within a certain vicinity of the watch.
Yeah, okay. So
in order for it to be accessible. Right.
Yeah.
So for me, the AirPods, here's my problem with the AirPods, and you're going to think I'm probably nuts.
Okay.
I think they look like tampons.
Okay.
That you're sticking in your ear.
I don't like that they're the ones I had were bright white, but do they make other colors? I didn't really have an option for another color.
That's my problem. I don't like the white. Yeah. Like you're sticking a little baby tampon.
Or tampons, but I think they look like hearing aids. I think they make you look like you have hearing difficulty, which is fine if you're handy capable, but I don't want to be, handicap appropriating. I don't want to be walking around with something looking like I've got, they're bulky. If they could get smaller, I'll tell you, you know what the greatest headphone invention is? Cause you know, when I was getting headphones here, Ed's like, what kind of headphones do you want? And I'm like, well, I don't like cans. Now, you're wearing the traditional, what they call cans. I don't like those. Because for a lot of people, they love cans because it blocks out the room noises and all that. I like the room noises. I like the idea that I'm hearing what the microphone is hearing. So I like that. The other thing that I like is that I'm very animated. Like, you know, sitting back and I do stuff like this. I would lose my headphones all the time. They would fall off and I'd have to put them back on. The greatest invention in ear technology that I've seen in my lifetime. Let me put these up here. Let me make sure there's not a whole bunch of gross earwax. Because one of the other things about wearing earphones a lot is that you produce extraordinary amounts of earwax. The little buds, man. The little buds that fit perfectly in your ear. And they're rubber, so they grip and they don't fall out. I mean, the first generation of what were earbuds were terrible. They were plastic and they fell out when your ear started to sweat. You know, these are great. And
are those wireless?
No, they are not. But they are fantastic headphones that Ed got me, and I couldn't be more happy. So these are perfect for like what I like to do.
Although I like my cans.
Yeah, Yeah, well, but you're not animated. You're very chill, so you don't have the same issues with. So look, I'm constantly. And if you were doing that, your earphones would fall off. Okay, so the Apple Watch series, I just don't understand. AirPods, awesome. And the iPhone, come on. Adam Raina says, if you keep buying a new phone every year, you're a moron or rich or both. Yes, because I think truly rich people who aren't morons understand the card game that's going on. they understand. Yeah, you're a good example.
I don't have a new phone.
You're not an Apple guy. No, I'm saying you're a good example of the guy who could go out and buy a new phone every time they come out, but you understand that it's a bit of a con.
It is. It's a huge con. I mean, they just add a camera and sell 4 million more phones because now the phone went from 3 cameras to 4 cameras.
Do you know who is making the release of a new Apple iPhone trend at number one? People between the ages of 22 and 30 who are still out in the bars, who are still trying to impress people, and there ain't nothing they like more than to sit up at the bar and put their brand new phone on. Why? Because somebody who doesn't have that phone, who's also in the cult of Apple, is going to go, is that the new? It's an icebreaker. Your phone, your cool ass phone, is kind of like what you use if you can't have a nice car.
Yeah, it's your Cadillac that you drop on the bar.
Yeah, yes, exactly. That's what it is. All right, so that's why Apple is trending number one. Also, this is great. This is not trending number one, but it was trending earlier. I thought this was a pretty cool moment. Did you watch last night's Monday Night Football game?
Oh yeah, I watched last night's Monday Night
Football game. I know we were on the air. But you had it on where you were, so you were witnessing.
If you're sports betting and you saw that game last night, you are so pissed off. Like, you might have quit sports betting just after watching that game.
Well, we should tell people it was between the Baltimore Ravens, Lamar Jackson's crew, versus the John Gruden Raiders at their brand new, is it Levi Stadium? The brand new stadium there in Las Vegas.
Alliant, is it maybe Alliant Stadium? I don't know.
Where's Levi Stadium?
That's in San Francisco. Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
And SoFi is California. AT&T is here. I guess I'm not sure. Raider Stadium, man. That's what it's going to be called. And that place looked really cool, man. I recorded the game specifically because I wanted to see how they covered the stadium. So after we finished here, I did what I usually do is I go back and actually what I did was I went all the way back to 4 minutes or all the way up to 4 minutes left in the fourth because you had said it's going to overtime. So I wanted to see how, because I knew now it was going to overtime. So why waste my time with 3 quarters? So I watched how it went to overtime and then I watched in real time the overtime stuff.
I don't even know that I dare get into this with you, but the total on the game, the betting total on the game was like 50 points, 50 and a half points, like okay. 50 to 50 and a half. And in the fourth quarter, okay, at the start of the fourth quarter, right, they needed like 30 points in order to go over the total. And then miraculously, this is, what you see on SportsCenter, a bad beat. Somehow this game went flying over the total. And, it was all due to the fumbles by Lamar Jackson, the field goals, the overtime. Oh, it was awful.
I'm trying to find the final score here. Do you have the final score?
The Raiders won by 6, I think. I don't think they kicked the...
What? No, because, it was next score. It turned into a next score win situation. Okay, this is really poor journalism. The story I pulled up about the game, at no point does it mention the final score. It just says the Raiders won. So,
I think it was like
33 to 27,
I think.
31-24, maybe?
No, I think they were tied at 27, is what I remember.
I don't know. It doesn't matter. The greater point that I'm trying to make is, and this has gone, at least as far as I can see, pretty much unnoticed. But you know who the hero of the game was?
The ref?
No. The hero of the game was the gay guy, Carl Nassib, the only out player in the NFL, the only gay man who is out and proud in the NFL is the guy who won the game essentially for the Raiders by stripping the ball from Lamar Jackson, and then the Raiders recovered it.
Yeah, final score was 33-27.
33-27. Okay, so yeah. So what would it have been in overtime? Was that your point about?
That was in overtime. It was 33-27. It got to overtime when it was 27-27.
So what happened in overtime was the Raiders got the ball. I don't know if they won the toss or whatever, but the Raiders got the ball. They were driving downfield. They scored a touchdown. It looked, you know, it was a touchdown. It was a total, to my eyes, game was over. But they're all celebrating on the field. Raider Stadium is going insane. The players are in a mosh pit. They're running onto the field. The Lamar Jackson Ravens are heading back to the locker room. And then you hear the referee, the final play is now under review. The game is not over. The game is not over. The game is, he kept saying it over and over again, and no one could hear him because the crowd was going nuts.
Right. And then they come back on the field.
Well, wait, hold on. Let me tell the story. Yes. Oh, go ahead. So, yeah, they come back on the field.
And then they come back on the field, and they're at the 1 yard line.
The receiver who busted out the coverage and was wide open on a beautiful throw from Derek Carr. His knee was down. He broke the play to the end zone with the ball, but his knee was already down. So he was down at the 1 yard line. The players after the Raiders, I mean, talk about an emotional drain. That when you celebrate after a big win in overtime, you are emotionally drained after that. That is a release of everything that you've been keeping pent up to make you frosty. And now it's gone. And they now have first down at the goal line, a 1 yard line. So it's still looking okay, right? It's like, well, we should.
You would think the game's going to be over in a play or two.
We got Josh Jacobs. We got Darren Waller. I mean, we got options here. We're on the 1 yard line. We're okay. Well, they didn't make it because Derek Carr threw a touchdown pass to, I don't know if he was a tight end. It wasn't Waller. I think it was a tight end, though. He threw a touchdown pass that went right through the dude's hands, bounced off the helmet of the defender, and right into the hands of the Ravens safety, who then took a knee, picked it off. So now it's not over. Now the Ravens get a chance to get the ball. When we say no story but does more. The insane thing about, I mean, I watched it, and it was one of those deals where, you know how they say, yes, accuracy is incredibly important in being a quarterback. Having a rifle for an arm is very important in being a quarterback. Being able to read defenses, pick up the mic, and make those audibles on the line of scrimmage, very important to be a quarterback. You know what else is really important to be a quarterback? Touch. Derek Carr just was 6 yards away from this receiver and threw it like 101 mile an hour Mariano Rivera fastball. It was just crazy bad.
Yeah.
Even though it should have been caught. But I saw that play and I'm like, oh, come on, man. What are you doing? The ball was thrown so hard that after careening through the wide open hands of the wide receiver, bounced off the helmet of the defender and probably went 20 yards into the sky. It was thrown so hard. I'm like, oh my God. So then of course the Ravens get the ball. I'm not sure. Oh, that's the whole point of my story. So the Ravens get the ball and they're marching towards field goal position because now the next score wins because the first, I don't know, man, these new overtime rules, I'm still grasping them. But they needed a field goal to win, and Lamar Jackson got sacked and fumbled in the sack.
And the second fumble, he fumbled in the fourth quarter, which led to a Raiders touchdown, and then he fumbled again in overtime, which led to another one.
And the guy who forced the fumble is the gay guy who wasn't even supposed to be playing. He's like a 6-7 year veteran, Carl Nassib. He's been in the league for a while, been a practice squad guy. I mean, he's not a superstar. You know, but he got in because of injuries and he punched the ball out. The Raiders recover it and then they go on to win the game. But I mean, I just thought that was, and look, I don't know. I'm struggling with whether or not it should have been, look at that, the first openly gay guy, or was it better that nothing was said because having nothing I mean, when Reggie White used to make sacks, we didn't go, you should have seen the stripper he was with last night. You know, I mean, we didn't get into the sexual proclivities of the players. So what do you think about that? Should it have been noted more? I mean, it was noted in the broadcast a time or two, but it certainly wasn't hammered like it was some, you know, progressive lefty broadcast. But after he made the win, I was like, that's the gay dude, right? You know, that's what I'm watching, thinking while I'm watching it. And yeah, sure enough, it was.
I'd like to think that someday there will not be that attention. I think that attention only creates more attention and more attention. And like, if it was like, okay, we'll accept the fact that there are gay people in this world and mm-hmm. they do this thing the same way that we do. Mm-hmm. Then it's a non-factor and it kind of goes away. I almost feel like by mentioning the fact that it's the gay guy that did it, you know, it continues to, oh, well, when's the next gay guy going to do something? Or okay. When's, you know,
I get that. That's sort of part of the point that I'm dealing with here. However, when it's the first one, I mean, you know what I mean? Like the first one, don't you point out that, hey, look, gay guys can play football. I mean, in some way, I'm uncomfortable with that. I guess I don't know where we are in the social progression of acceptance.
And, well, I don't know. Where does the thought process come because you're gay, you're not capable of playing football? We went to your son's football game last night and we saw a girl on the field.
Yeah. And she's good too. She's one of the better players. So that's... that's a different question. Where does the thought come? Well, I mean, there's a lot of people who have never met a gay person. Well, they have, but they just didn't know it. And, you know, there is bias. A lot of dudes, man, especially still people our age, who are angry that they can't say fag anymore. You know, I mean, it's like, it's a pejorative. That's why you can't say it, because it's a mean thing to say, you dummy.
Well, I mean, the diver, Greg Louganis. Yeah. He was gay.
But that's diving. That's not NFL football.
Right. But is it okay to be gay because you're diving and that's somewhat, I guess, gymnastics?
Yeah, it is.
In the air?
Yeah, that's totally fine.
That's what. and so you wouldn't be shocked then if a gymnast was gay?
No.
But you know how strong you have to be?
I'd be shocked if a gymnast was straight. Well, right, but there you go. Those are old school narratives, how strong you have to be. Dude, gay dudes are just as strong as straight dudes.
So why can't they play football? Which is my point. Yeah. You know, it's like...
You're an evolved individual who moved past the 1970s narratives. I mean, you understand this. That's
you ever see a gay biker bar?
Yeah.
Some of the guys in there? Well, but I mean... They exist.
I've seen gay bikers. I've seen gay guys at the gym. This is the narrative that we're fighting, that if you're gay, you're this whole thing that was the accepted narrative for, I'm not going to say 1,000 years, because quite honestly, if you go back to medieval France, a lot of those guys were very, and they were kings and stuff. So, but I mean, certainly within the last 70 years of America, the social perception, the social narrative that has been drawn around being homosexual is that you're a florist, or that you're, you know what I mean? It's always been that. And that's always been wrong. And the other thing that's crazy about this NFL thing is the idea that he's the first, and this is why they have to, you know, qualify. He's the first openly gay person in the NFL. Because there have been a crap ton of gay dudes in the NFL. I know a member of the 85 Bears who was at the very least bisexual. He was married, but I believe later in life he became a fairly free and open gay guy. And I know this firsthand from other 85 Bears who have told me, who have said, oh, yeah, he's and those old school Neanderthals, they still love him. You know, they're still like, so there have been gay players in all the major sports. I mean, we know that it's been in basketball. I can't think of his name, but there was a guy that came out in basketball like 20 years ago. And there have been, you know, not openly. Well, he came out after he retired. My point is, every sport. Athleticism isn't determined by your sexual interests. It's just not. You can be a super athlete and also be into guys.
I agree.
And we seem to be more accepting of that with women. I mean, there have been lesbian women who performed at the highest level for years now, who everyone has known is gay. Billie Jean King is a great example of that. Martina Navratilova is another great example of that. So, I mean...
And on the flip side of that, they are thought to, oh, well, of course she's going to be a champion because she's gay and she's a woman. Like, somehow when you're gay and you're a woman...
Then it makes sense.
Then it makes sense. Yeah. You know?
Because she's like a dude.
Right.
A dude is better than a woman at everything.
Right. Right. It's the total opposite. If you're female and you're gay, then it's expected that you're going to have a technical advantage over the straight women.
I think of the WNBA as a predominantly lesbian league. And that's borne out. I mean, they have they're open about, you know, their girlfriends and all. So that's it. But again, WNBA is such a progressive league. I mean, you want to talk about a sports league that really drives the folks in Alabama nuts. WNBA. And like nothing about that. They're athletic. They're black. A lot of them are homosexual. Whoa, that's a problem there. So here we go. Raiders defensive end Carl Nassib did not make history last night, but he did make progress. Celebrated by corporate media as the NFL's first openly gay active player, the six-year defensive end made the biggest play on Monday Night Football midway through overtime. Nassib sacked Baltimore quarterback Lamar Jackson, causing a fumble that allowed the Raiders to win a wildly entertaining game. In a game filled with Las Vegas scapegoats, Nassib was the unquestioned hero. I mean, you know, the irony here is that the gay guy bailed out the straight guys who totally screwed up. You know, Derek Carr with his no-touch fastball of five yards at 100 miles per hour. The guy who dropped it, what was his name? Willie Snead. That's it, Willie Snead who dropped it. Let's see. Alex Leatherwood, who was that was the other thing that happened where you thought the Raiders were completely melting down. They're on the 1 yard line. They've first and goal at the 1 yard line, and then their guard Alex Leatherwood blows into a false start. It's like, so now they're moving it back, and it's like, oh! And the only reason that the sack was allowed to happen, no, the sack happened none. Hold on. Who's this call? Oh, look at that spam risk. I should ignore it. Usually I turn my phone down.
I get scam likely. You get spam risk?
You get scam likely?
Yeah, that's what it says on my phone.
Man, I like that better. Yeah, I get spam risk. I like that they're scam. Dude, this is, I like that much better. All right, so I guess the thing that I'm struggling with here is what was the proper way to handle it? Did you say, well, look at the gay guy? You know, because that will have social consequence. I mean, there might be a gay young football player out there watching it who doesn't know or whatever. But I do on the other hand. Here's the side I think I fall on. I think I fall on the side of not mentioning it is probably the greatest indicator of progress, that we just need to get over this. We need to stop worrying about who people are sleeping with. I don't care. I don't really care, man.
I agree.
All right. I'm going to take a drink, and then we'll get on to the next topic here on High Noon with me, Pugs, and him, E.
My drink for the afternoon.
Yeah. The prescription medication that I'm taking for these allergies, they give me cotton mouth. It's like I'm surprised I haven't had to get up and go to the bathroom yet because I've been chugging water for a couple of hours here.
It's weird. They one gives you cotton mouth. Two gives you the flop sweats.
No, these are different drugs.
Oh, okay.
The one that gives me cotton mouth is the real thing that actually helps me. The two things that made me have an anxiety attack where I thought I was going to die, I thought I was going to die, man. I did not know what was going on. When you're my age and your body starts doing things it has never done before, that's scary. I was really scared. I mean, I appreciate you guys being there for me and you, the listener, who understood that something was happening with me and I needed to take about 40 minutes and just go shower and lay down first. But the stuff I'm on, the only side effect is, well, actually, it works wonderfully. The stuff I'm on makes my voice sound a little bit sexier, although I'm starting to lose it. But it gives me cotton mouth really bad.
You make a good point. As I get older, I think about, okay, when I am going to check out, what is the sign that I'm starting down that road that I'm not coming back? Like, mm-hmm. like what is going to be like, is my arm going to go numb?
Tingling and, all of a sudden you can't watch TV without your arm falling asleep.
Yeah. And then something's happening and then this never happened before. Mm-hmm. And here I am progressing down the road of no return. Like, right. Do you ever spend your time thinking, okay, when I do check out of here, how's it going to happen?
Oh no, no, no. That because I'm depressive. So I have a good bet on how it's going to happen. I just not now or anytime soon, but when everything goes to garbage, yeah, I have a pretty good idea that I'm going to head it off at the pass. But that's, you know, that's another sort of thing I have going on. But I will tell you the scariest thing that I've ever experienced that was new. And that was when my heart started screwing around. When I got injured, I injured my heart in an accident, stupid wrestling accident, trying to get in shape. And I had what was called a myocardial concussion, contusion or concussion. I don't know, but basically it was explained to me like a concussion of the heart.
Okay. But so still it could be a contusion that acted like a concussion.
Yeah, but it was explained to me when the doctor was telling me what was going on, because I'm like, did I have a heart attack? And he's like, No, you didn't. So don't worry about that. You know, we've looked at your file. You're fine in that department. Your cholesterol is good. You don't have any, you know, issues with your heart. But what you did was you concussed your heart. And I remember saying, I go, well, where is that on the scale of a heart attack? And he goes, it could be worse. The doctor said it could be worse. And I'm like, what? And so he explained to me. But when that happened to me and I was taken immediately to the emergency room, which luckily was right across the street from where I was. Well, not right across the highway from where I was. It was a 5-minute car ride. The experience, the feeling that I was having of when your heart begins to struggle, and there's probably a lot of dudes who have had heart attacks, and I don't know if it's a similar feeling, but when all of a sudden this area right here, you start to feel something in here, that's scary. That was scary because you know, it was fine. They just kept me in the hospital for a day and then they monitored my heart to make sure it wasn't swelling and that there wasn't like a bruise around it that was going to cause problems with the arteries and stuff and getting blood flow there. And then I just had to, you know, lay low for a couple of weeks and then go
Did
back.
They bring in the paddles and give you the shock?
No. It never got there. Thank God it never got there. But I had to lay in an emergency room with all of these. They shaved my chest and they stuck all these sticky things on me and I was all wired up. And then the next morning, the doctor came in and he wanted to keep me another day, but I was, all my signs were fine. My vitals were good and the x-rays were all right. But they said, you know what we're going to do? We're going to send you down for, and anyone who's ever had a heart issue or maybe even lung issue, I don't know. He said, we're going to send you for an endurance test. Now I've just been through hell. And I spent the night in a hospital with drugs in me and all that. And now they sent me down to some room where they hooked me up again to all of these sticky things. A stress test. And made me just go nuts on a treadmill for like 40 minutes. It was the hardest workout. The nurses were really cute. And I was already feeling old and like, you know, just decrepit. So I was really trying to run. You know, I'm like, really? Yeah, ladies, check this out. I run. I was wrestling. And I'm telling you, like 5 minutes in, I was like, okay, can we stop? And then they're like, yeah, you can take a break. We're monitoring your heart. Your heart's doing fine. You're fine. You're just tired. I'm like, yeah, I am. I mean, I couldn't do that. Stress test was a bitch, man. That was hard.
Stress test to me seemed like it's almost like waterboarding. Yeah. It's like, okay, we're going to take you all the way to that point where you're just not going to check out, you know, but we want to see how high we can get you before you fail.
Here's what we're going to do to you now. You're in the hospital. You might have a heart issue. So if everything goes to shit, you'll be fine. We got the machines right here. We can bring you back. But let's see how close to death we can bring you right now before your heart gives up.
It's the waterboarding, you know, with a stress test.
It's insane.
It's odd. It's
cruel. All right. So congratulations to Carl Nassib. I hope you never have a myocardial concussion or whatever it is.
And all you people that bet the over that lucked out.
Yes. Yeah. Man, what a great game. What a great, I mean, look, present company excluded. Our teams sucked. So both the Bills and the Bears and the Cowboys, they all lost. But other than that, what an incredible opening week of football for the NFL. They shattered ratings. They but the Thursday night game between the Cowboys and the Tampa Bay Buccaneers was the highest rated primetime non-postseason game in NFL televised history.
And it was the most amount of underdogs to win since 2000, I think in three is what I read. Mm. So sports books, all the, you know, FanDuel, all these places where people are legally sports betting now. Mm. This was their banner weekend, you know, because more people than not bet the favorites. And I was reading articles on sports books saying this was the best weekend that they've had ever. And, you know, since it got started.
The Sunday night football game also beat all ratings of Sunday night games last year. It was the debut of SoFi Stadium in LA. So you, but also you had two major markets with the big TV markets anyway in Chicago playing Los Angeles. So that's always going to be a high ratings thing. But the Thursday night game really interested me because the Thursday night game between our Dallas Cowboys and the defending Super Bowl champion Tampa Bay Buccaneers. That game setting the ratings the way they did for, I mean, you knew the ratings were going to get a bump because it's the first of the year. So the first game of the year, there's going to be more interest than there would be on a regular Thursday night. But those ratings went stratospheric. And what I think is most interesting about that is that it featured teams from Texas and Florida. And if I remember correctly, I would think that those were two of the states that were most in on the, I'm not watching NFL football anymore. I am done. Did you remember those people?
For sure.
Not going to watch NFL football. Well, somebody in Florida and in Texas turned up in droves to watch that game. So, I mean, you know, child, that's just how we are. We're all so childish nowadays. I'm going to give up my lifelong obsession with NFL football because that half white, half black quarterback took a knee. Stop it. Yeah, but before I thought the same thing. Yeah, it's just interesting that it was a team from Texas and a team from Florida that set the records. It wasn't a team from Boston and a team from San Francisco. You know, it was two states where all of that, let's not watch football anymore, pro football, NFL, because remember it was NFL football.
When I brought that topic up to some people, it was like, okay, I'm going to give them another chance. If they do it again.
How convenient for you. How right. convenient for you in not having to give up something. You bloviating fool. Stop it. It's football. We enjoy it for reasons other than the politics that you're dragging into it. I have never. Here's the other thing. You know, the whole kneeling, whatever you feel, man. Hey, if you are against it, that's fine. I have people that I respect and like who are against it. I have people who I respect and like who think that it's a worthy cause and social justice is something that, you know, athletes with influence should be involved in. Fine, whatever. But do you know that until recently, the only time they televised nationally national anthems was in the postseason or a wild card game or a playoff game or the Super Bowl. You did not, they routinely for 30 years in the NFL went to a local commercial break while all of that on-field stuff was happening. They didn't show it. It's only now that they've started showing it again because so much attention has been brought to the idea. You know what I mean? So if it wasn't reported that they were kneeling, my point is nobody saw that shit. Nobody watched that happen.
And Thursday night, they did the national anthem twice. Yeah, on Channel 5.
I still don't know that that's right.
It is right. I'm telling you.
Conflating God Bless America with the national anthem.
I asked James. He was there.
Yeah, and he also admitted that he was drunk on 11.
Yeah, he was 11 bottles in on Southern Comfort. Yeah, that is a disclaimer that he did give us.
But yeah, you might be right. I just don't understand why they would do that. Seems incredibly ham-fisted.
Like they were baiting him.
Yeah, maybe. Well, one for Texas, one for Florida. they both got to get their version.
Like a hockey game, one for the Canadian national anthem, one for the American national anthem.
I actually like that. I've been to a number of, oh my God, I just refreshed my Google Trends and they're making me not re-sign in, but prove that I'm human. And I don't know if this is an N or an H. I'm going to go with an N. Oh man, there are so many. There are so many.
Doesn't it irritate you when you get the zero? Is it an O or is it a zero?
I know. I always put an O. If the others are letters, I always put an O. Why am I supposed to know that you suddenly got cutesy? You're asking me simply to put down what I'm seeing. I don't know your motivations here. I don't know why. Oh, boy. Okay, let's look at what's happening now. It's a bunch of, let's see here, top stories. That's what we want. Just giving a quick, before we jump in, we've got things we'll talk about, but Man United, Cristiano Ronaldo is one, Chelsea FC is two. We got Donald Trump, Mark Miley, and Bob Woodward at number three. I don't need any of that. None of that is good. Although I guess of some national importance, California recall is tonight. Kevin Newsom is, okay. Let me just say what I think about Gavin Newsom. I think that's a guy who looks good in a suit. I don't think Gavin Newsom is a great leader of men. I don't believe that he's, I don't live in California, so I don't really know what's going on there. What I'm saying is I'm not a shill for Gavin Newsom. However, the other choices, because you get two choices in a recall election. So when people in California go to the ballot box today, they're going to see, should Gavin Newsom, governor of California, be recalled? Yes or no? That's easy. Then the next question is, who should replace Gavin Newsom? And then there's like 46 names. Not one of them is legit. They're all like YouTubers and people who want to be on. The guy that is leading the pack is a guy who has absolutely no chance of winning. And that's just this guy, Larry Elder, who is an extreme. His political affiliation is on the extreme. Okay. And maybe some might say Gavin Newsom is on the other extreme, but it looks like Newsom's going to win fairly handily. There have been a lot of outside money coming into this because Larry Elder, who is, he's one of these AM talk radio firebrands.
He's on Fox News like every other week I see him when I turn on Fox.
Yeah, yeah. And he has openly said, and this, why would he do this? I mean, this completely torpedoed his campaign. Gavin Newsom was up by like 20 points the last time I looked recently. But before that, there was actually some struggle going on that maybe this Larry Elder guy could make some traction. And then he went on TV and said, Dianne Feinstein, the senator from California, is old. It may be time to replace her. And if that happens, I will appoint, you know, one of the far right senator to, and that would flip the Senate and that would cause all kinds of problems. And the minute Larry Elder went public with that, outside money started pouring in to Newsom's recall fund. And that's when you had Biden going out there and making appearances. Obama went out there and made appearances. Kamala Harris. I mean, and then it's just forget it. It's over. It's like they've motivated the left base in California and he started to pull away. So I don't understand, unless Larry Elder never really wanted to be governor. He just wanted the attention that this run would bring him. And then he'll go back to doing radio.
Yeah, I didn't understand the strategy. I do understand why it was a rallying cry for the blue, because California, with the size of it is, you can't afford that state to turn blue if you've got visions on maintaining or you know, winning the election again in 2024.
80% of California is San Francisco in that metropolitan area, Los Angeles and San Diego, that massive metropolitan area. And with the exception of Orange County and with the exception of Northern California, everybody is a California liberal. You know, I mean, there is a reason why California has, well, I mean, they elected Schwarzenegger, right? Right. But I don't think he was necessarily seen as a scary Republican. You know, I think he was a fun Hollywood Republican.
And then there was Barry Goldwater for years.
No, he was Arizona. Goldwater.
Oh, yeah, yeah, that's right.
No, Jerry Brown. I think
Jerry Brown. That's what it was. Jerry.
Yeah,
Brown,
yeah, yeah. They were trying Jerry Brown. First of all, which one are we talking about? His old man who was governor for a while? Or, I mean, but they also had Reagan. So California, like Texas, has gone back and forth, but it is perceived predominantly being a progressive state. So I don't know. They just motivated the big cities and they got people who weren't going to pay any attention. I mean, that's how people won recall. That's how Gray Davis lost the recall to Arnold Schwarzenegger, because there was no motivating factor for him. People thought, this ain't going to happen. This ain't going to. And then it happened and you had the governor and people were like, whoa. So they've been reminded of that. And the base, the core of the California voter, who is, for lack of a better word, a lefty liberal, they've been motivated. And, you know, could be wrong. There could be whatever. But already before the first ballots have been cast, well, I guess some ballots have been cast because they've been voting, you know, absentee and by mail and stuff like that. Larry Elder has already declared that the election has been fixed. they haven't even closed the polls. And he said, I want an investigation. This is a... So that's what we do now. That's what we do. We don't lose. You know, the Baltimore Ravens are calling last night's Monday Night Football game a fix because they didn't lose legit because a gay guy. Gay guys aren't supposed to... I don't know what their argument is. But okay, so that's a big story without trying.
It's going to be trending for today, tonight, tomorrow. I mean, you know, it's just we better get used to Gavin Newsom trending for the next few days.
So I just think that this is funny and probably a very important piece of American history as we move forward. So I would be remiss if I did not note it. But the reason that Trump and General Miley is trending right now, and Bob Woodward, is because Mark Miley told Bob Woodward, you know, Woodward and Bernstein, the Watergate guys, General Miley told Bob Woodward that when transition was happening with Trump, Miley made secret phone calls to other generals and other people in the military to make sure that Trump got nowhere near the nukes. Nowhere near him. He was like, there's, because when January 6th was happening, apparently, you know, look, that makes me a little uneasy. I don't like that generals are, but also at the same time, I can completely see why he felt maybe that was important to do.
What would he have done, though? I mean...
Well, okay. Well, we'll find out. We'll see what he did. Oh, man, it's the Washington Post, which means they're not going to let me read it. Top general was so fearful Trump might spark war that he made secret calls to his Chinese counterparts. All right, hold on. Yep, and there I go. I have limited access. That's it. Now the big box just appeared.
So he starts a war, so basically we can't transition from presidents. That was kind of the thought process.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. Oh, and then the other thing that's trending is, I guess this is also a Woodward thing. Trump told Pence that during when the January 6th stuff was starting to happen, Trump told Pence that I won't be your friend anymore if you don't overturn the election.
Was he ever really his friend?
No, I don't know.
But I mean, with a friend like that,
but that's why they distance themselves. That's why Trump and Pence are no longer, you know, whatever they were. But I mean, that's funny. That's just funny to me. I'm sorry. That's just funny that someone, the most powerful man in the world, would use the playground logic of, I won't be your friend anymore if you don't share your lunch with me. You know, it just seems so basic. All right, let's see. What else is happening here? We got to the Apple iPod. Okay, so here's something fun that we can get into. Are you familiar with... Jessica Chastain was trending. Do you know who... Well, Jessica Chastain is an actress. God, I love Jessica Chastain. Or is it Dallas Bryce Howard? I don't know. They look the same. I like them both. Who was Miss Sloan? That was a good movie. Who was in the poker movie?
I don't remember. I know the name and I'm trying to picture the face.
Oh, just pull her up. Go ahead. You got time. I'll talk for a while. But actually, I'll just Google this. Jessica Chastain, Dallas Bryce Howard. and then you'll get the idea of why I don't know which is which. They look like the same person to me. They're both, one is Ron Howard's daughter, and the other one is like a two-time Oscar-nominated actress. They're both very good in everything they do. But Jessica Chastain is trending because her new movie is going to be released on Friday. And we're going to watch the trailer for it. We like to do that here because this is a movie that I have been wanting to see since the first time that I heard this movie was coming out. And it's Jessica Chastain playing Tammy Faye Mesner, Nee Baker. Remember Tammy Faye? Remember that whole deal?
Mm-hmm. She was,
Ed points out that Jessica Chastain is in most of the movies that I like. She is. I love her. I think she's an amazing actress. There's a whole bunch of these actresses that I confuse, though. And I think I did a Facebook post about it a while ago because the actress Jamie Presley and the actress Margot Robbie are, to me, I can tell them apart because one does TV and isn't considered the hottest A-list actress in Hollywood, and the other is. So, like, Margot Robbie, who is... you know, Harley Quinn in the Suicide Squad movies and all that. And then Jamie Presley, who I think is probably best known from, was she in Joe Dirt maybe? And then she was also in the TV series. Anyway, they look identical. And then there's the other two that I always confuse, who are Amy Adams and Isla Fisher. If you ever saw these two, they're like, wait, which is which? And I think Hollywood does this on purpose. It's like, we really want Amy Adams, but we can get Isla Fisher. Done. Fine. No one will know the difference. But Dallas Bryce Howard and Jessica Chastain are also two that just, my God, they look the same. All right. So here, let me pull this up. Yeah, we'll do it this way. Yeah.
I pulled up a picture of Jessica Chastain and Harvey Weinstein.
No, but I told you to do both their names because then you'd get side by sides. Google will give you side by because it's not an original thought that they look alike. It's like something that a lot of people, you know, have noted in the past. All right, let's see if we can do this. So Jessica Chastain is playing Tammy Faye Baker in the brand new movie, The Eyes of Tammy Faye. And I will tell you what, Pugs, why would Pugs be so excited about a movie about Tammy Faye Baker? Well, I will tell you in a moment, but shall we enjoy this? The first trailer, or not the first, the latest trailer for a movie that's going to be released on Friday in theaters, The Eyes of Tammy Faye. Here we go.
Tammy Faye, what'd you do?
Hello, Mother. This is Jim Baker, my husband.
It's all part of our mission to help people. Anyone who's hurting or they feel like they've been left out, God has a plan for us.
What'd he tell you to do this time?
Jesus keeps a-taking me higher and higher.
Jim will preach, and I'll sing.
Higher and higher. God does not want us to be poor.
Wonderful, a pleasure.
Now God has a voice in this fight.
Who's he fighting?
Liberal agenda. Homosexual agenda.
Faith isn't political.
You can't talk to him like that.
Jerry Falwell is a powerful man, Tammy Faye.
She's a firecracker, Jim.
If everyone watching could double their pledge just for 1 month.
God loves you. He really does.
We're not doing anything wrong, though.
Is that a question?
Tammy and I are undergoing the most vicious attacks.
Serving God don't feel like it should be a money-making opportunity.
You know, when I saw that clipping with my face on it, I thought for a second that you were proud of me.
Oh, Tammy Faye, you follow blindly. In the end, all you are is blind. These
eyes. I just want to love people. Cry
every night. The devil's coming for me, Tammy.
Can we talk about Satan later, Jim?
Steve is a patient of AIDS.
I can't look at this. You need to get her under control.
I built you an empire.
I built you an empire.
Some people, they're just hurting so bad, and we just need to love them.
I want to put my arm around you.
And I want to put my arms around you, Tammy Faye.
I won't go forward looking in the rearview mirror of my life.
This is who I am.
All right, so there it is. That is the trailer for the new Jessica Chastain and Spider-Man. Andrew Garfield, Spider-Man, is playing Jim Baker. Now, for me and the things that I enjoy in film, that hits a whole lot of checks, a whole lot of boxes. I love real stories based on true events, no matter how Hollywoodized they are. And I like, well, okay, that's about it. That's the only box that checks. But I really, and I like Jessica Chastain. I love her. Now, here's why I had such a unique interest in this, because I feel like I know Tammy Faye Baker. I've spent a lot of time with Tammy Faye Baker. I sat with her. She ate lunch with us. We interviewed her multiple times on the show that I was on in Chicago. And every time that she came, now look, Tammy Faye was, Jim Baker was a crook. Jim Baker was a complete crook. But Tammy Faye was a bit of a clown. And, you know, she wore the crazy amounts of makeup and she was always so disgustingly optimistic and so happy. And I don't know that she was a good singer, but boy, oh boy, did she just sing anyway. And it was, she was fun. She was fun. Jim Baker to me was disgusting. That guy was a complete con man. But Tammy Faye was not the same thing.
The way he looks, Jim Baker looks portrayed in that movie to me, it's like Mr. Rogers went religious.
Well, Mr. Rogers was religious, but he kept it stifled.
But in this movie, he looks like a religious Mr. Rogers.
Yeah, okay, I can see that. Now, I don't know if there is a purpose of this movie other than to tell the story. But here's the thing. Okay, so let me tell it to you this way. So Tammy Faye Baker was somebody on the radio show that I was a producer on in Chicago, Kevin Matthews, the legendary Kevin Matthews. Tammy Faye was somebody who was the butt of a lot of jokes back in that era. I mean, if you remember, she was everywhere. She really was everywhere. You kids, they did a nightly religious show on one of the cable channels, and you know, normies didn't watch it, but for the faithful, you know, it was a very highly rated show. They loved that thing. It was like the Tonight Show with Jesus. It was, you know, it was that. Right. And because of that, her presence on television, even among people who never watched Jim and Tammy Faye, it became omnipresent because she was such a weird looking lady. She
would make Saturday Night Live skits all the time.
She said, we asked her once, she came in and sat and talked, and I cannot tell you enough what a wonderful woman she was in real life. What a sweet, kind, courteous person she was. But I remember one of the interesting things was you ask about the makeup, like, okay, so you understand. What her story about the makeup was, she was raised in a house where she was never allowed to wear makeup, where it was forbidden because only whores wore makeup. You know, that's the kind of house she was raised in. And she was a very pretty girl. She was like the prettiest girl in her high school and all that stuff, but she never got to wear makeup. So then all of a sudden they're just given a TV show, and it's not like a Hollywood production where they have makeup artists and like all of this kind of thing. And she was allowed to wear makeup. And she didn't know how to put on makeup.
And no kidding.
Yes, yes. But she was also incredibly insecure about her looks, about going on TV, because she was always beaten. All the boys were always after her, but her mom and dad beat into her head that she was ugly and that she wasn't pretty and nobody would ever want her. So when she was finally given an opportunity to wear makeup, she put on way too much. Like, and that was like in the early days. I mean, it was pancaked on. It looked like a clown. And that's, I called her a clown because that's what she looked like. She didn't know. She had never applied it before. And because it was like a non-Hollywood show, she had to do her own makeup for the TV, you know? And she did it. And all of a sudden, people started just commenting about her makeup. And she realized that this is how cool of a lady she was. She realized that, well, a lot of people are laughing and a lot of people are talking about it. And you know, I don't mind what they're saying because I don't know how to put on makeup. So I'm not really going to personalize those attacks. And she stayed with it. She realized that it was her brand. So she just became this kind of thing. And in later life, I mean, she toned it down, like after the Jim Baker thing. And we're going to watch a couple of clips of the greatest daytime talk show of all time, which was the Jim Jay and Tammy Faye show. Do you remember this?
I don't.
Do you remember Jim Jay Bullock from Too Close for Comfort? Monroe?
No.
You don't remember Too Close for Comfort?
No, my brain is...
All right. Early 80s TV show, Ted Knight. The guy from Mary Tyler Moore.
I know Ted Knight. Yeah.
He was a cartoonist. It ran for like, I don't know, 6 or 7 years. It was good. When I was little, I watched every episode. He had two hot daughters that lived downstairs in their beautiful San Francisco brownstone. And the two daughters had a roommate, and the roommate was Monroe. Now, it's very Three's Company-ish because Monroe was, you know, very, although they never identified Monroe as gay. Jim J. Bullock's character of Monroe Ficus was never described as gay, but he was the gay character in the show. He was obviously gay. It was San Francisco. He talked about, I was out at the clubs all night and I am exhausted. You know, and they would do jokes like he would sit down and he'd like move like he'd be uncomfortable. You know what I mean? Like it was that kind of gay humor. But Jim J. Bullock was a gay man. He was a gay man. And after the whole Jim Baker scandal, Tammy Faye left him, divorced him, was like, I've had enough. I've been thinking about leaving you for years. And she was given the opportunity to do a daytime talk show with Jim J. Bullock, this openly gay, flamboyant guy. And now the outsiders would look at that and go, wow, this crazy, far-right, religious TV woman is now going to have to sit on a couch with a gay man every day? That's going to be interesting to watch. But what people didn't know was that one of the reasons that for the last year of their marriage, Jim Baker and Tammy Faye didn't speak at all, because Tammy Faye had become an AIDS crusader. And if you remember back in that time, 89 and 90s, nobody on religious television was, you know, talking about the AIDS crisis.
It was a gay disease is the way that it was looked at.
And gay was anti-God. Gay was, you know, against the laws of God and all that. There is a scene in that clip where he says, a guy, she's interviewing someone, and he says, I wish I could put my arms around you. And she says, I wish I could hug you too. And then you see backstage Jerry Falwell say to Jim Baker, you've got to get her under control. Because she was one of the few people. She believes Tammy Faye's view of Christianity is that Jesus's love is for everybody. It does. And as a non-Christian, as an agnostic, as someone who still describes himself as a searcher, that's the shit right there, that Jesus's love is for everybody. And if, because I was raised Catholic, man, I know about Jesus. I know what he was. I had to take tests on him and what he actually said and what he was all about. And those are the things that I cling on to in my regular life. I mean, I believe that Jesus was the greatest influence, the greatest human influence. Now that's a trigger. That gets a lot of people going, what do you mean human? I go, I'm not sold on the whole, I'm a good Jew on this one. You know, I'm not sold he was the son of God.
A Jew on this one.
But he sure was a good dude. He sure was an awesome dude in those influences that he put forth. The way he lived his life and the things that he preached are absolutely etched in stone, wonderful things for humanity. I tend to believe that the modern Christian world, like Jim Baker, as we are going to see in that film, have corrupted Jesus's message for their own gains, but for political power. You know, if you can rally everybody up against something that's different that they can all hate, you can control them and you can tell them who to vote. So that's sort of my take on that. But Tammy Faye was never like that. Tammy Faye was truly the kind of person that was her belief in Jesus. But Jesus's love is for everybody. It doesn't matter if you give us money on this show. It doesn't matter if you watch this show. It doesn't matter if you're a murderer. Doesn't matter if you are and I think that's a good message, because I truly believe that that was also Jesus's message, that he was here for all of us, not just the people who joined his club. And so anyway,
well, they teach that in the Catholic Church. Jesus was everybody that's Catholic.
Yes, and everybody else is going to hell.
Right.
Now that's the reason I stepped away from the Catholic Church, because I went, really? So we're the cool kids. We're the cool lunch table. That's it. Everybody else is going to hell. But somehow our little group with the big hats and the flamboyant robes and the, you know, trillions of dollars of gold buried in the basement, we're the ones that are right. The Jews? No. Any other kind of Christian? No. You know, so look, that's, I like to look at these things emotionally, but also intellectually. And intellectually, those things don't check out. They don't. It's, come on. Aren't there more Buddhists in the world than anything else, or Hindus, or whatever it is? So, you know, they're the biggest gang in town. They're all going to hell. Anyway, well, I don't like to get into religion and faith talk, but when people say that I'm an atheist, I get upset, because people need to understand the difference between being an agnostic and being an atheist. I was raised Catholic. I'm not faithless. I'm just still searching. I'm still looking for the thing that clicks that I go, yeah, that's the one. Okay. So, the show was supposed to turn heads with this flamboyant gay man and this religious Tammy Faye Baker. Jim Jay and Tammy Faye aired on the UP. Oh, and by the way, it should also be mentioned that the whole time that she hosted the show with Jim Jay Baker, he was HIV positive, and he was public that he was HIV positive. And the way that Tammy Faye interacted with him, the show wasn't allowed to go very long. I think it maybe aired one season and a half. But I mean, the way she interacted with Jim Jay Bullock, they were best friends. They were like huggy and touchy and all of that stuff. And it also should be noted that Jim Jay Bullock, who was HIV positive all the way back in 1996, is now a 67-year-old man who's completely healthy, and he's just been taking the AIDS drugs. So look at that. There's something that science built that worked.
Well, I'd watch that show. I mean, if you told me it was happening today, just the two opposite sides of that spectrum, both people, sound like it would be interesting dialogue.
Well, good for you, because we happen to have some clips that I want to show here of the old Jim Jay and Tammy Faye show. Now, the first one I'm going to show you is I'm going to show you the promo. Okay, so this is the promo that they would have aired, you know, coming to UPN.
On the next Jim Jay and Tammy Faye show.
Hold on.
Took a tiny little
All right, so I got to go back here. All right, let's see if we can make this work. It was the greatest, most wheels off, insane daytime talk show that I have ever seen, between this extraordinarily religious woman and this extraordinarily homosexual man. And it was just, it was too much for 96. I mean, Ellen was still in the closet. It was way too much for 96, but it was some real brave and ballsy TV, and it was great. And that's actually how I got to know Tammy Faye. Because Chicago being a big UPN market, she came to Chicago a lot. And she came on our show. She came on a show that she knew had been, you know, known to make fun of her. And she won us all over. She was just wonderful. Okay, so here we go. Here's the promo for Jim Jay and Tammy Faye. Let me make sure we have it. Okay, we do. All right. Enjoy, folks. This is television greatness.
On the next Jim Jay and Tammy Faye show.
Took a tiny little bite.
All right. I'm a rattle.
I heard of a lady who killed her poodle doing this once.
That is so scary, Tammy. That is really scary.
I tried to dry my husband's underwear in the microwave oven.
It doesn't work.
No.
You like Diet Coke. You just drink it all the time.
I like to drink it like this, you know. I like to drink it like this, like Kathy Lee drinks it.
You're...
Monday at 6 on Channel 26.
It was wheels off crazy. It was like one of the most fun you could have at 2:00 in the afternoon.
I used to dry my husband's underwear in the microwave.
Yeah, I mean, look, you know, let's be honest. This is back when I was doing morning radio, and I'd get off work at 11, start getting high immediately. And then just, you know, I'd roll into like a half hour of Teletubbies straight into Jim and Tammy, or whatever, the Jim Jay Tammy Faye show. So maybe my perception of what was quality television was a little skewed. Okay, but here, we'll show you this one. This is one last one that I want to show. But man, is she dead? I think she did die. I think she died. Well. Jim Jay's not dead. All right, here, let's see if this one will work. All right, here we go. Hold on. I'm doing a lot of things myself here. If we were on the radio, this would be much more fluid. But we're not. We also don't have bosses, so that's nice. All right. There we go. We're streaming. All right, so this is just like a random intro to the show. Here they are, the Kusum Tusum.
Oh, look at them.
They're holding hands. He's HIV positive.
An incredible looking house. What a great looking audience. How are you all doing?
Do you recognize him at all now, Jim J. Bullock?
No.
He was a regular on Hollywood Squares as well. He was like always on Hollywood. He was like the Paul Lynn of Hollywood Squares.
Okay.
The new Hollywood Squares.
Right. I know.
Good to see you. Yeah, full of energy, full of coffee. Yeah.
And I see somebody that's still in their bedroom. Come on now.
This is where I'd be rolling a joint waving. You see me, Tammy?
Magic mirror.
They're couch potato for today. So yes. That's fine. Everyone deserves
it. Stay right where you are for just a moment. For the show.
But don't clean house because part of the segment today that's is right. on housekeeping.
That's right. It's going to show them how to avoid doing it.
Yeah. And we all want to know about that. And, I've got this hot dog. Yeah. I'm carrying around this hot dog with me. You like hot dogs. I really don't care for hot dogs because what goes in the hot dog is why. I'll eat a tofu dog or a veggie dog. Anybody had a veggie dog or a tofu dog?
Ugh.
Yeah, they're really not bad.
This is where I'd be yelling at the screen.
I like veggie dogs
better
than tofu dogs.
But they don't taste like a good old hot dog.
Well, yeah, but you know what's in these things? If you've seen Babe, you wouldn't be able to eat this. You wouldn't be able to eat this.
I know.
But if you've seen Babe...
All right, we don't need to watch the whole 2.5 minutes, but this is the idea of what was going on the old, the greatest television daytime talk show in history. Just these two people who you would never expect to be friends are just best of pals. One's a flamboyant gay man and the other, Tammy Faye Baker. I got one quick Tammy Faye Baker story. Just, I said I had lunch with her, a bit of overstating it. So you know how at radio stations, from time to time, someone will cater a whole bunch of food. And then like at, you know, noon on a Tuesday, there'll just be like a spread in the green room like you've never seen before.
Right.
Well, we used to get that regularly at the Loop in Chicago where I work. And it was, I think it was right out. I think the show had just ended. And in true Tammy Faye form, she probably came on at, you know, 9:30 in the morning, blew right through her allotted time, stuck around and hung out and just, you know, commented. She was wonderful. I cannot stress enough how wonderful Tammy Faye was as a person, as someone who had totally preconceived notions about what this woman was going to be. So the show ends. And because the other shows would end a little bit earlier, you had to get to the green room to get the good food, right? And so she's walking out of the studio, and me and my producer at the time, a guy named Doc, the late, great Doc Simpson, we're like, let's go get some food, man. Yeah, come on, let's get some food. And we bust open our door, and her door to the studio is right next to it. So we both emerge in the hallway at the same time, and we start to run. And Tammy Faye goes, where are you running to? And we're like, free food. And then Tammy Faye started running right behind us. She's like, I'm hungry, wait up. So we got in there. We had, I think it was barbecue or whatever it was, and we're eating it. She was just wonderful. So that's why I'm so excited about this movie, because you know, she was somebody who opened my eyes that you can't really judge a person just by what you perceive them to be. She was not terrible. I think her husband was a piece of shit, but Tammy Faye was cool. All right, so that's why that's trending. Tammy Faye, The Eyes of Tammy Faye, starring Jessica Chastain. By the way, did you pull up a Bryce Dallas Howard, Jessica Chastain photo?
I did. You can't tell them different.
Yeah, right? Yeah, now do Amy Adams and Isla Fisher, Isla, and it'll fill in the rest. Because
wow, Tammy Faye died in 2007.
Yeah,
that's how long ago.
I think it was Jim Baker still alive, because that would really, I mean, if you're a godly person, that doesn't seem right. that both of them were spreading, unless you believe that, you know, God wanted Tammy first.
Yeah, he's still alive.
Oh my God!
Well, you know, January 2nd, 1940.
He's got a son who goes by the name of James Baker. It used to be Jim Baker Jr., but he changed it because his son has completely distanced himself from his dad as well. But he's not. He's also doing the sort of pastor game thing. So, well, look at me. Preconceived notions. You know, I just assume that he's following after his dad. He's distanced himself from his dad, and he was very close to his mom. So maybe he's, you know, continuing her version of ministry and not her dad's. And you know what? He very well may be, because he's been doing it now 20 years and I don't know him from TV. I don't know him from making provocative statements on Fox News. So maybe Jim Baker's son is being, what are you laughing about?
Televangelist Jim Baker sued over fake coronavirus treatment.
Oh my God.
March 11, 2020.
He's back at it. He's back on the horse.
Yeah, it said the Missouri Attorney General asked the judge to block the sale of Baker's silver solution.
Oh, my goodness. Well, God bless you. All right, let's see. What else do we have here? Let's see what's trending. If there's anything else good. Oh, cops. Remember the tip. Bad boys, bad boys. What you gonna do? What you gonna do when they come for you? Remember Cops?
I do.
Cops is being rebooted. Now, you may have been like me who, well, actually not like me, because I knew it was taking off. But that show had run for 30-something years. I mean, it was just every Saturday. My memories of Cops as a young man in the 90s is it was on at 7, and then there was another one at 7:30. They ran two episodes in a row on the local Channel 32, which in Chicago was Fox Television. So they ran this at 7, between 7 and 8, and all of my memories of getting ready to go out to the bars in my 90s and you shaving and all that was with Cops on the TV in the back, you know? It was,
right.
I'd be half shaven and I'd come out and I'm like, what is this guy getting into? What did he do? You know? So I have a soft spot for Cops. I always thought it was a fun show. But then they had to pull it back because, you know, a couple of years ago, here's the problem with Cops, and it's there was another show called the Live PD. Do you remember that show? It was on a couple of years ago.
Yeah, they would drive A&E. Around in the cars on A&E.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, on A&E, exactly. Now, Live PD to me was a much cooler version of Cops, because Cops was, they would go and hang out with cops for a week, like Monday, Sunday through Thursday, film all of this stuff, edit it on Friday, and then get it to air on Saturday night. So it was all edited, and it was all, you know, they knew what was going to happen. What Live PD was is exactly what it says. It was Live PD. It was camera crews, raw footage of cops pulling people over, cops responding to domestic disputes, all of that kind of stuff. And I really enjoyed Live PD. The first season Live PD was on, I was this is the greatest, this is the craziest show. Because you could sit there, and it was always on a Saturday night, and you could just sit there and you could watch like a cop just driving down the road, and the cop would turn to the camera and goes, okay, see that's improper lane usage. And I'm like, all right, here we go. And then woo, he'd light him up, and you never knew who was in the car. And it was all very exciting. It was like, well, ooh.
That was as close to reality TV as you could get, because you didn't know what was going to happen with the criminal or the offender in the other car. Unlike reality TV, it's scripted. Hello?
Yeah, I'm sorry. Just distracted by something.
Oh, okay. Well, fair enough. But yeah, my point was, is that Live PD was closer to a reality TV show than reality TV itself.
Okay. Breaking news happening right now. I'm going to be redirected. I will skip this ad. Sorry.
Chat room.
Yeah.
Beat you to it.
Yeah, thank you. That's what I need. The chat room are my de facto producers here. Cops on Fox was gone. It was taken off after all of the police shootings and all of that. Same with Live PD. Fox Nation, which is the streaming service of Fox, is rebooting Cops, and it'll be back for a 33rd season. Norm MacDonald has died. Norm MacDonald. Influential comedian and former SNL Weekend Update anchor was 61 years old. Boy, this is going to be a big one, because Norm MacDonald was seriously beloved in the comedy community. He was considered by many to be one of the all-time greats who, you know, didn't rise to the level of a Pryor or a Carlin or something like that. But it was only because of his refusal to do anything that he didn't want to do. If you remember, Norm MacDonald lost his gig on Saturday Night Live for making OJ jokes. And everybody tuned in because of his back in the early 90s when OJ Simpson was, you know, on the front pages everywhere because of what he did. And yeah, he did do it. Norm MacDonald on Saturday Night Live as the Weekend Update anchor, who also many people believe he's the greatest Weekend Update anchor of all time. I may disagree with that. But Norm MacDonald made endless OJ Simpson jokes. And it got to the point where Dick Ebersol, the executive producer, or not the executive producer, but one of the executives at NBC, who was very close friends with OJ, told Norm MacDonald to stop it. And of course, that became public. So let's say that becomes public that Norm MacDonald has been told to stop doing OJ jokes on live TV on Tuesday. The whole week was, oh my God, what is Weekend Update going to be? Because last week it was just 15 consecutive great OJ jokes being rattled off by Norm MacDonald. What is he going to do? And Norm MacDonald, I believe he addressed the situation in the opening of SNL's Weekend Update live TV. He addressed it. He said, I've been told not to make, and then proceeded to do 20 minutes of or 20 consecutive OJ Simpson jokes. He was fired. He was fired for disobeying. It was a bit of a controversy, but that's who Norm MacDonald was as an artist, as a performer, as a thinker. He was not going to let some suit, some executive, and it to some degree torpedoed his career. Here's the story. It's just breaking now, and we've got this even before Wikipedia has updated it. Wikipedia still says he's alive. That'll change within the next 5 minutes, I'm sure. Norm MacDonald, whose laconic delivery of sharp and inclusive observations made him one of Saturday Night Live's most influential and beloved cast members, died today after a 9-year private battle with cancer. Sure was private. I had no idea.
Didn't we do a station appearance with him on McKinney Avenue? I think it was at the across from the Hard Rock.
No, I met Norm MacDonald a number of times back in the 90s on the other station, but I think you're thinking of Kevin Nealon.
No, I'm sure it's Norm MacDonald.
But Kevin Nealon is another awesome guy.
We did an appearance with him, or maybe he was in town as an improv comedian.
Maybe. I think Norm MacDonald, I think of someone who I've met many times. Maybe I just forgot about that particular instance.
Yeah, I remember that was, it was next to the Hard Rock. I think maybe it was Fat Rabbit or what, it turned into Fat Rabbit. I can't remember what it was, but I remember doing something.
He's been sick with cancer for years, and I had no idea. And I'm pretty up on, so it was definitely, it says here a 9-year private battle with cancer. Had no idea. He wasn't, I guess, not the type to, you know, talk, I've got cancer and here's my, what I'm saying. No, he was funny until, he was a funny guy. He was edgy. Now he got very edgy in the last couple of years, like the political correctness and shit he was not down with. He didn't give a crap. And now I think we know why. Norm MacDonald said he always did risky jokes, but he really upped it in the last couple of years, turning a lot of people against him. A lot of people who are otherwise, you know, pussy liberals, if you don't mind me saying, but it's Norm MacDonald. It's comedy. This guy's mind has always been amazing. I mean, why would you? But it sort of makes sense now. If he was privately battling cancer and he knew that he didn't have another decade or two to live, it explains why he was just throwing it all out there. Like, this is what I think.
Let it rip.
Yeah. He had said things in the last couple of years where I'd gone, oh, God, what is he thinking? His career is over. Well, now we kind of understand why.
Kind of the way you look at grandma or grandpa at the party. They don't give a crap. Right? It's just like, I'm too old to deal with this crap.
I want to tell you something. I don't like your husband. I never have. Right. You get that kind of stuff from grandma. She don't care. Right. And we're laughing because I don't believe Norm MacDonald would want anybody to be sad. That guy was just all about making people laugh. MacDonald's death was announced to Deadline by his management firm, Brillstein Entertainment. The comedian's longtime producing partner and friend, Laurie Jo Hoekstra, who was with him when died, said MacDonald had been battling cancer for nearly a decade, but was determined to keep his health struggle private and away from family, friends, and fans. He was most proud of his comedy, Hoekstra said. He never wanted the diagnosis to affect the way the audience or any of his loved ones saw him. Norm was a pure comic. He once wrote that a joke should catch someone by surprise. It should never pander. He certainly never pandered. Norm will be, here's what I would tell everybody to do right now. Go to YouTube and just search Norm McDonald takes on other celebrities. I mean, there are just endless things of it. And these are some of the things where I went, how does he expect to work ever again in Hollywood talking about Steven Spielberg that way? Or, you know what I mean? It was like crazy things. And it's all starting to make sense. I mean, seriously though, YouTube, some of Norm had a show on Netflix recently. And it was one season last year, and it was terrific. It was the Norm Macdonald show, and it was just him interviewing other people, and his questions were awesome. That's the show now that I think, that's the show where I went a couple of times, oh my God, how is he allowed to do? Well, now we understand why he was, and now we also understand why there was never a season two, because we should be on season three by my count of the Norm Macdonald show, because it was 2 years ago and it was good and everybody loved it. He was most proud of his comedy. He should never pander. He certainly never pandered. Norm will be missed terribly. Macdonald was scheduled to be in the New York Comedy Festival lineup in November. Macdonald was an SNL cast member from 93 to 98, making his greatest impact as the anchor of the show's Weekend Update segments for three seasons. Remembered both for his droll style and for his refusal to go easy on O.J. Simpson, despite reported pressure from NBC execs. That's the story I was just telling you. Macdonald would prove one of the most impactful update anchors, pivoting away from the slapstick approach of Chevy Chase and towards the more barbed political approach of his successor, Colin Quinn. I would absolutely put Norm Macdonald as one of my two favorite Weekend Update. I don't know that he would be my favorite, and I might shock you when I tell you who my favorite Weekend Update host. Remember, I've seen every episode of Saturday Night Live. That's one of my party tricks, going all the way back to when I was a little kid watching it with my mom. I think the best Weekend Update, I think Norm Macdonald is too, and I think the best Weekend Update anchors are the ones they have right now. Colin Jost and Michael Che are so good together.
I agree with that. They are good. They're the best two, so I think, good that they've had at one point in time.
Yeah, yeah. Norm Macdonald, I think I would slide in there a second. Let's see here. And for his refusal to go easy on O.J. Simpson, despite reported pressure from NBC execs, Macdonald would prove one of the most impactful update anchors, pivoting away from slapstick and more into political commentary. Born on October 17th, 1959, just shy of his, well, I guess not shy, in Quebec City, Montreal, Macdonald, is that where Quebec City is? I just said Montreal. Yeah, I would think. In Quebec City, Macdonald started his show business career in the comedy clubs of Canada, developing the deadpan style that would become both his trademark and a highly influential touchstone for generations of comics to come. A contestant on Star Search in 90, he was hired to write for Roseanne Barr's sitcom before landing the coveted gig on NBC's Saturday Night Live. I typically don't like to read the entire thing, but because this is breaking right now, I have no knowledge of what's going on here. Macdonald's departure from the show was controversial in itself, and he often attributed his firing to his continued lambasting of Simpson as a murderer, despite what he said was the displeasure of Don Olmeyer. Who did I say? I didn't say Don Olmeyer. I said Don. It's Don Olmeyer. Whoever it was, I apologize. I get these two NBC execs confused because they're similar names. Yes. Despite attributing his firing to his continued lambasting of Simpson as a murderer, despite what he said was to the displeasure of Don Olmeyer, president of NBC's West Coast division, who Macdonald said was a friend of the former football great. After leaving SNL in 98, McDonald starred in his own comedy series, The Norm Show. Yeah, I forgot about the sitcom, The Norm Show. That was a good show. I liked that. From 99 to 2001, he also did a one-season talk show for Netflix. Norm Macdonald Has a Show. That's the one I was telling you about. This was in 2018. He also earned a Cable Ace Award nomination as part of the writing team for the 1992 variety special Free to Laugh, a comedy and music for Amnesty International. Over the years, he made numerous appearances on various television shows. Oh my God, pop-ups. Always selling. Always be closing. And did it again. Over the years, he made numerous appearances on various late-night talk shows, including Late Night with David Letterman and Conan, and had a recurring role on The Middle, This is the Developing Story, More to Come, dot, dot, dot. That is really sad. That's not good. Jennifer Martin says, Colin Quinn is the absolute worst SNL news guy. Disagree. Totally disagree. The absolute worst SNL news guy was the pairing of Dan Aykroyd and Jane Curtin. The only thing they're remembered for is Jane, you ignorant slut. But they had nothing. Neither of them.
That still makes me laugh.
Yeah, okay. So that was a good line. It certainly permeated the American popular culture for a while. The joke there for you kids who don't get it was that it was a man and a woman news anchor team, and they would do like a point counterpoint thing. And the woman would always go first, and she would make these impassioned points. And then it would be thrown to Dan Aykroyd, who would always open with, Jane, you ignorant slut. The reason you're wrong. But that was it. It was a one trick pony. That was pretty much all there
was. It was a one trick pony that got out of the gate every weekend.
That was good. I'd like to pull some Norm Macdonald stuff. You know, play it here in the last couple of minutes of the show, but can't do it. I mean, I don't know. At this stage, I don't know what we can and can't play. Everything that we have played so far on today's show, the clips and all that, I had to clear with Big Ed. This morning, I called him. I said, okay, I want to play this. Can I play this?
Well, I mean, the poor guy has been getting just lambasted with offenses.
I know.
It's just every time we play something, it's like, you got whatever citation, I don't know, written up, in trouble with the principal, whatever the hell happens.
Yeah, right. I don't even know what's happening. I just know that it irritates Ed, and I work very hard to make sure Ed isn't irritated. Although, when irritated, Ed is at his most entertaining. That is when Ed really shines, when he's irritated and ranting.
Ed's irritated personality is something that needs to be exposed.
Yeah. And I believe we talked about this recently, where I said the great thing about when Ed goes off on you is that it only lasts about 45 seconds. He immediately calms up. He unloads everything in 45 seconds, and then he's back to being Ed. But he definitely has, it's like, I guess that's like a thing with tech guys who get so incredibly frustrated dealing with us troglodytes who don't know anything. Like whenever Ed tries to show me something, like he's built out this amazing studio, the Radio Misfits Clan, they've just been so cool to us. I don't say he's part of it. I mean, he's part of the operation. This is his bottom line too. But whenever he tries to explain something to me, he skips over like 16 basic introductory things that I need. Okay, first what you do is you double click to the left and you download into the more tools section. Wait, what? No, that's the first thing? How do I turn it on? That's the first thing.
Right.
How does the laptop open? Does it? Oh, I see. Okay. I think that's a pretty normal thing that tech guys deal with every day with people like you and me who, all you do is just download it. I've been online for 20 years. I'm not sure I know. I download things all the time and then have no idea where to find them. Like, where'd they go? I downloaded them.
Right. It's in your phone somewhere, and then you'll like, I'll get to the gallery and of my phone, and I'll think, where'd this picture come from? I deleted that like 3 months ago.
Right.
How is it still here in my phone? I don't get it. I would be like if I was doing crime and I was like somehow using my phone to take pictures or camera, like they would catch me immediately because I don't know how to get the evidence out of my phone.
That's why I do that. I have never in my life, I guess younger people who are more phone savvy and stuff, I have never in my life looked at porn on my phone. Yeah, people are like, oh man, download Pornhub mobile. I'm like, why do I need Pornhub mobile? If I'm going to be masturbating to Pornhub, I know where I'm going to be. I'm going to be in my room with the door closed. I don't need to be mobile with that. But the reason, one of the big reasons is I wouldn't know how to stop it from just popping up randomly sometime somewhere. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I'm with you there because it's like, have you ever gotten those emails where they're like, I am sending you this email because I have hacked into your computer. Sure. And I know that you've been looking at this nasty site and mm-hmm. we have images of you doing this, this, and this. And I'm thinking to myself, okay, you had me up until that point. I know that I've never done that. So you don't have images. So this whole email that almost got me is BS.
See, now that's interesting because I've never had that. I thought you were going to go a different way with that question. I've never had that. That would scare the shit out of me.
Oh, yeah. They say that we've seen you on the camera doing so-and-so. And I'm like, no, you haven't.
Oh.
Because I haven't.
Yeah, right. Well, not on my phone, brother. I've never looked at anything. My kid plays with my phone. There is absolutely no way that I would know how to set it so that it... Well, I don't know enough about my phone to know that it couldn't just pop up at a random moment. Yeah, I just don't know what I'm doing, so I don't do it. Laptop, I get it. You go into your browser, you go incognito because you don't want anybody ever seeing the sites that you went to. And I know that that's not, look, I'm being a little bit funny here. I have absolutely no issues with my sexuality. My sexuality is null and void. That's pretty much it. So this is all stuff from the past.
You want to hear some auction lingo?
Well, yeah, you know what? Here's where we're at right now on the show. We had a couple more things to get to, but Norm Macdonald died. We don't really know much more about it. It's really kind of a bummer. I don't want to just kind of spin off into something else. So yeah, let's spend the next 4 minutes the way we started talking about the thoroughbred horse race auction that you've been distracted by all day.
All right, hip number 269 is in the ring. And...
they call it hip number because that's where the number is on its hip.
Yeah.
Who's this horse?
This horse by Justify.
He is an NBA player of thoroughbred horses. Justify is the NBA with the million kids.
It's a filly.
Okay. That's going to drive the price down. Are they doing the auction? Is that what's happening? Is it like,
You don't hear that?
No.
Oh, I'm hearing it right in my phone. Or in my ears.
There you go. Now we can hear it. Man, that's a job. I could do that. I talk real fast.
It just sold for $190,000. It's like that auction lingo. Like, what is he saying?
Wait a second. This whole time today I've been talking to you, you've been listening to that in your earphones?
No, I just turned it on now. I thought you could hear that.
Yeah.
Okay, here's another Justify.
Is that the horse making noise?
Yeah, he just walked him in the ring.
He doesn't sound happy.
Also under the first dam. Prayer book has additional earnings since the catalog.
He hop in the pen to get 500. He able to get
500. Hey, he's kind of got the DJ voice too. All right, everybody, welcome out. It's the Bowden Show. What did that one go for? Oh, this is going to be illegal, isn't it? Isn't this going to be another one of these red flags because we were listening into a horse auction?
I don't know. Ed's up here taking control of the computer.
Irritate him.
No.
See if we can get him to go off since we just talked about how funny he is when he goes off. 525, and coming up after that, we've got the new one from Nickelback.
At 2050, 75 bids in, back bullet 75, at 75, 600.
59 minutes after the hour, 1 minute before the top.
625, 50 here, you're able to get 75, at day here, you're able to get 75, now 700. I'm on, it's 7, that broke the tie, 725, bids in the back, 725, 25 here, you're able to get 25, you're able to get today, you're able to get 25, ground back bullet 750, 100, at 25, 50 here, you're able to get 75, out DC 775, at day here, you're able to get 75, 75.
Right, ridiculous.
Let's hope that by 2 o'clock we get a final price on this horse. I like this guy. I want to know who this guy is now. I had no idea where I grew up that this was a career path option.
Hip number 273 is out. 273 went drawn to the sale.
750,000.
That's what I thought. I thought I was hearing ridiculously high numbers, but I didn't know if they were actually the price or if they were just numbers on cards that people were holding up. Like they were so that one sold for almost $1 million.
Exactly. 750,000.
Wow. Isn't that one I'm guessing is a boy?
That was a boy.
And the girl just sold for what? Like,
well,
200 grand and a bucket of chicken.
Well, the female horses can be valuable too because they have offspring, and if their offspring run and you sell the baby, you can get yourself, you know, $1 million or so at the sale. Like,
hey, what did I just do? Because you just suddenly went low res.
He came up here. I think what he was trying to do is get the video images so people could see him
All right.
On the camera. But
we're gonna miss him. He's leaving us here at the compound for a couple of weeks to go do real business. And then he's going to come back. All right, that's it, folks. We're going to be back at 10 o'clock tonight for the Pillow Talk edition of this little thing we do two times a day from noon to two. We call that High Noon with me and E. And then we come back at 10 o'clock every night for a 10 to midnight version that we call Pillow Talk. I can probably, we're obviously, more is going to be revealed about Norm MacDonald. There's going to be tributes. We're going to talk about that. We're also going to do a very big version of American Vidiots tonight at 10 o'clock. I have been compiling some of the best stuff. I was thinking we would do it every day, the way on the old show we used to do audio oddities every day, but you can't do it every day. You got to do it when it's good. And man, I've been compiling stuff over the last couple of days. Maybe some of it you've seen circulating on the social networks, but we're going to do a jumbo edition of American Vidiots. Okay, that's it for us. That's all coming up tonight at 10 o'clock on the Pillow Talk edition. Thank you for joining us here for the High Noon edition. I'm Pugs, he's E. This has been the Radio Misfits Network. We'll see you.